do that, I'm going to travel back to the 1920s, when the sounds that you'll hear in a second were a revolution. From New Orleans to New York, skyscrapers were replacing the old cathedrals, and jazz was forming a new kind of mass culture and mass music, a new secular space to replace old sacred cultures, and man was reinventing himself. A new mankind was forming with new sexual norms, where flapper fashion was replacing the dresses of old, and in which a massive cultural revolution was taking place in the West. The Soviet Union had just come out of a bloody revolution and was deciding how to reconstruct its culture that had been smashed by years of civil war. The question of this reconstruction would be how the Soviet Union, a new communist nation, would situate itself within the formation of modern mass culture. This was an issue that was extremely pertinent for Soviet cultural planners, because the creation of mass culture was a way of transmitting the ideals of the party to the toiling masses, a way of bringing the workers to consciousness, perhaps the primary motive of the Soviet state. And so the question of how to integrate itself into modern mass culture was one of key cultural importance. And at this time, the newly forming mass culture was jazz, and it was a culture that had come out of New Orleans and come out of Harlem, and now was emblematic of Western wealth and Western consumerism. It was a new era that the Soviet Union would have to figure out how to relate to. And the 20s were a time of relative cultural pluralism within the Soviet Union, where the country was deciding what shade of red it would adopt. It was into this atmosphere that a futurist poet named Valentin Kadamak traveled back from France, where he'd been studying, in 1923, excited by the mission of creating new Soviet culture, and decided to import the sounds he had heard at cafes in Paris, that of jazz. In the Soviet Union, he formed an eccentric jazz band, eccentric being a word he had picked up from a futurist manifesto. And as saxophones had not yet been produced or imported into Russia at the time, he couldn't find a sax player. The most exotic and eccentric instrument that he played was the banjo, which at that time was a revolution on Soviet stages. Unfortunately, recordings of this music don't persist, but we can assume that the attempts at syncopated rhythms and at jazz improvisation must have been a little bit forced. Nonetheless, jazz in the Soviet Union would thrive, and a pianist named Alexander Fassman, who studied at the Leningrad Conservatory but dropped out of the composition and classical piano program when he fell in love with recordings of American pianists like Fats Waller, decided to transcribe what he heard. And by the late 20s and into the 30s, Fassman became one of the most famous musicians in the Soviet Union for compositions like this one, The Sound of Jazz. And Fassman would intimate the styles of American jazzmen, ushering in what scholars now consider from 1932 to 36 to have been the Soviet jazz age, or the Red Jazz Age. It came about 10 years later than it did anywhere else, but it did happen. And Fassman and his band were known throughout the country for being rich, gambling, drinking, sexual, the kinds of epithets that applied to American jazzmen. For Fassman, the standard of authenticity would be American jazz. And even in the contemporary English language literature on this topic, people still think of American jazz as being the standard for jazzes around the world. One thing that you'll see if you look, for example, to the website of the United Nations on the International Jazz Day that the United Nations now runs, is that jazz is an American art form. Jazz is the music of freedom, and jazz is the music of peace. My thesis, however, is aiming to challenge these notions, partially through an alternative form of jazz that came out of 32 to 36, the Red Jazz Age, which was the music of Utyosov, who was one of the most famous stars of Soviet cinema and musical culture, who said that American jazz was a bourgeois form and tied to consumerism, but that jazz was initially a black folk music that came out of African Americans' experience of coming out of the bonds of slavery. It was a product of class struggle, and so it could not truly be free until it reached the soil of the Soviet Union. Black culture could only realize its true power through the hands of Russian musicians, because consumerism would always hold it down in the US. Utyosov developed a distinct style of jazz, which, unlike Fassman's, didn't involve much improvisation. partially probably because the musicians were not trained in it and didn't have really any access to interacting with American musicians. And with talented composers like Dunayevsky and even Dmitri Shostakovich, the famous classical composer, as well as the band leader Skamarovsky, released a series of films, including one called Happy Folks and one called Volga Volga, that were probably the most famous films of the 30s in the Soviet Union. And Stalin loved them. Stalin called Volga Volga his favorite film of all time, a film designed to transmit party ideals to the masses, but based on an American pop cultural form, a jazz opera that would teach people to come to self-realization of their own material situation. This music, however, would not come without a backlash. When Stalin took over in 1928, the Soviet Union entered a cultural revolution. And during this time, the bureaucracy was radically reorganized. The Russian Association of Proletarian Musicians, which was anti-jazz, took control to such a degree that even eminent classical composers like Shostakovich were afraid and were demonized in the press. Shostakovich had published a jazz foxtrot called the Tahiti Trot that was really just an orchestration of an American standard, and issued a letter to the editor of Rockland magazine denying culpability for having done so because he was publicly insulted in the Soviet press. Nonetheless, after the failures of the first five-year plan and after industrialization of the Soviet Union had some disastrous consequences, Stalin backpedaled in 1932 and established a centralized union of composers that actually integrated jazz elements. So from 1932 to 1936, jazz was an officially sponsored cultural form in the Soviet Union, and one that would become very famous and important to the formation of Soviet mass culture. By 1938, however, things changed again, as the two leading Soviet newspapers started fighting over the jazz that had risen to such prominence in the Soviet Union. One argued that jazz was always a bourgeois consumerist form that needed to be stripped from Soviet society and replaced with folk music and classical music. The other, Pravda, argued that jazz in the West was a consumerist form, but that it could be modified in the Soviet Union, that a new form of Soviet jazz could be created that would be capable of making party ideals hummable. It would be capable of creating a modern mass culture in the Soviet Union through adapting an American model and removing its capitalist elements. And Pravda won. But 1938 was also the years of the purges in the Soviet Union, which meant that a huge number of the Soviet jazz musicians who had been famous during the Red Jazz Age were sent to the Gulag. Many of them died there, many of them were sent to work sentences and then drafted into World War II. And so the old guard of Soviet music largely ended up in prison, except for a few who were influential enough and knew people at high enough places that they worked. And these were the people who would participate in the creation of the new jazz culture as Pravda had hailed. That was Gosjazz, or government jazz, which was a form that flourished in the Soviet Union starting in 1938. A state jazz band was established for every single Soviet republic, including in Central Asia all the way into Russia. And there was also a central radio jazz orchestra, which played on Soviet radio waves, which was ultimately led by Stassmann, and a state jazz band of the USSR. In 1938, it had its Moscow premiere, which Stalin attended personally and loved, and premiered at this great premiere of Soviet Gosjazz was a commissioned jazz suite by Shostakovich, which actually has come to some fame and was featured in a Stanley Kubrick film, even though it's not kind of linked to this era of government jazz in the Soviet Union. So as this new style was formed, in which improvisation was taken away almost entirely, and in which more symphonic style elements were introduced, jazz would become a collective planned form. And perhaps that does link up with the narrative that improvisation is something that teaches people to be free in a way that the Soviet state didn't want them to be, which is a narrative that would emerge surrounding jazz during the Cold War as the US State Department funded jazz missions to the Soviet Union. But that's getting a little bit ahead of the story, which is that the new Gosjazz styles would become extremely important during World War II, because the Soviet Union needed mass culture and needed mass music in a way that it had never needed mass culture before. It needed something to get people through the war, to get people in the cold winters through this time. And these were records that were circulated between all of the troops. Indeed, by World War II, every military division had its own state-funded jazz band. The only problem with that was that most of the musicians had been sent to the Gulag in the 30s. So who was to play this new mass music? Who was to play the new national and nationalized music of the Soviet Union? Ironically, it was primarily to be Jews who fled the Nazis and ended up on Soviet territory. The most famous of which you hear now was Eddie Rosner, a trumpeter who grew up in Berlin as a Polish Jew playing jazz, perhaps the worst position one could have been in when Hitler took power, who traveled around the world, toured to the US, became a personal friend of Louis Armstrong's, and competed against Armstrong in a trumpet competition in which Rosner won second place, Louis Armstrong won first place, and Louis Armstrong gave Eddie Rosner a picture signed to the white Louis Armstrong from the black Eddie Rosner, which would create the epithet that lasted throughout Rosner's existence in the Soviet Union, that of the white Louis Armstrong. Rosner's band traveled to the front throughout Siberia, went through the country, and took songs like the St. Louis Blues and made them the songs of the Soviet mass military effort during World War II. These were some American jazz standards, were some of the most famous compositions at the time. And Glenn Miller films would finally be released in the Soviet Union, those of the American big band that was stationed in New Haven at the time, would become hugely famous on the front lines in a time of relative cultural amity between the Soviet Union and the US due to the military alliance. Indeed, after the war, it seemed that Soviet mass culture had won a huge victory, that the Soviet Union had won the war, and that the new culture created during the time of it would be man's new culture. It seemed that jazz had won the final victory, and that Soviet jazz, not American jazz, was the form that would become the dominant musical form in the second half of the 20th century. But things changed again. Because by 1948, Stalin had changed his mind about a lot. And many of the Jews who had fled the Nazis and ended up in the Soviet Union were sent to the Gulag and ended up in Soviet work camps. This includes Rosner, who was accused not of playing jazz, but of trying to illegally flee to Poland. And many of the Jews and musician refugees, as I call them, who ended up in the Soviet Union at this time, were sent to Soviet work camps. Those who didn't have ties to foreign cultures were not quite as frequently sent to the Gulag, but many lost their positions, including Zwassmann, who was ordered to stop playing and reportedly showed up at the Moscow Composers Union with flowers from his garden and said, "This is my new occupation." So jazz became all but illegal, and indeed only on the periphery of the Soviet Union could jazz flourish by that name. Rosner, even though he was in the Gulag at the time, formed a jazz band which traveled throughout the Gulag system with camp official support, because even though the music in Moscow and Leningrad was illegal, the Gulag officials had relative autonomy and liked it too much to give it up. Gulag jazz became one of the dominant forms for which it existed, and also in exile in Siberia, musicians like Oleg Lunstrom, who you hear now, created a jazz band that traveled between the Soviet Union and China, but very much on the periphery. In the center, in Moscow and Petersburg, the word jazz was stripped from dictionaries and encyclopedias. The transliteration DZHAZ that had arisen in 1923 when Pragmach invented it disappeared from the Russian language almost entirely. And even when musicians got out of the Gulag, it was called light music or variety theater. So, how was a new generation of Soviet jazz enthusiasts and jazz musicians to form? There was no longer the opportunity to learn from mentors. There was no longer an old guard that could teach them how to play. These musicians, which would become one of the dominant musical classes in Soviet society, learned entirely through listening and transcribing recordings. And what they listened to were American, Voice of America broadcasts, on which broadcaster Willis Conover, who was the longest-serving jazz broadcaster in history, made Soviet musicians privy to the kinds of developments that were happening in American jazz as new, technically virtuosic styles like bebop were forming. These musicians were hearing about all kinds of new things that were happening in the West, and they were fascinated by it. But they weren't just relying on radio broadcasts to get their music. A new Soviet youth class called Stilyagi, or Style Hunters, would get bootlegged recordings. The problem, though, was that it was so hard to smuggle in foreign recordings that when you got one in, it would be copied many times. These bootleggers, however, due to Soviet market regulations, were not allowed to buy vinyl or copying machines. They made the machines by hand with spare parts that they found in junkyards. And then for vinyl, there was a Soviet regulation that hospitals every year had to get rid of the old x-rays. So they used the plastic from the x-rays and cut them out in the shapes of records, and then etched the records with their bootleg machines that they had gotten from the few party officials or youths who had snuck them in from the West. These jazz on bones records, or ribs as they were called, still displayed the x-rays that had originally stood on them. They had human bones and hands and vertebrae on the records as a visual illustration of a trend that was happening in Soviet culture as people were turning away from institutionalized forms of expression, and a disconnect started emerging between Soviet society and a youth culture that existed inside of it with a kind of interiority that had never existed before. These musicians, however, would see the ban on jazz end, which would happen partially because rock came to the Soviet Union on the kinds of distribution channels that had been established for jazz. And with this new, even more rebellious music, jazz was now the lesser of two evils. So by the 60s, the Soviet Union re-legalized jazz and undid a ban that had started in 48, in which the saxophone was banned from importation and production and on Soviet stages. Jazz was now to be an institutionalized form again, and the Komsomol, the Soviet youth organization, founded jazz clubs in which the new generation of musicians would cut their teeth. The other thing that this did, however, was it meant that jazz was no longer a mass music because rock was becoming the mass music. So musicians like Alexei Kozlov, who you hear, the saxophonist, used the sounds of rock guitar and of rock harmonies in jazz to create a Soviet fusion style and try to become a sort of jazz rock star, particularly as rock was still an underground form at this time. The other thing that happened was diplomatic efforts meant that jazz had to be re-legalized in the Soviet Union. And the Iron Curtain of sound first began breaking down in 1959 when a professor at the Yale School of Music, who still teaches there today, Willy Ruff, traveled with the Yale Men's Russian Chorus to the Soviet Union. It further broke down in 1962 when Benny Goodman traveled there as a sign of goodwill after the Bay of Pigs disaster in Cuba had strained relations between Kennedy and Khrushchev. But Soviet musicians did not take these tours lightly in the way that the State Department had expected them and that the American literature would lead us to believe. Instead, when Benny Goodman came, Soviet jazz critics and musicians complained that a white consumer musician was sent instead of a black musician like Duke Ellington or Dizzy Gillespie. Soviet musicians had developed their own tradition of jazz criticism that was distinct from what existed in the West. And instead of just making Soviet musicians and Soviet people like America, the American musicians that were sent over were controversial because Soviet musicians saw themselves as having a cultural claim to their own jazz and to a jazz tradition more authentic to black culture than what existed in the US. So what ended up happening was that with these new jazz scenes forming throughout the Soviet Union, new musics and new subgenres were coming out. In Azerbaijan, a new form was invented that blended traditional Azerbaijani styles with jazz. Soviet musicians were seeing themselves as the inheritors of the jazz tradition in a way American musicians never could be. And in this process, in which there was greater cultural freedom for jazz, the first histories of Soviet jazz emerged, particularly in 1972 when Alexei Bakashev published a comprehensive jazz history through the Moscow Composers Union. Interestingly, there's only one English language history that spans this full topic, which was written by Fred Starr, who at the time was head of Oberlin University. But Fred Starr's book reached the Soviet Union, an underground publication, and Soviet musicians and critics didn't like it. What Starr essentially argued was that jazz would make Soviet musicians and people more Western and teach them to empathize with American culture. The Soviet critics disagreed. They saw that Soviet music was going in a different way and that Soviet jazz was going in a different direction than in the West. And so by the late 70s and 80s, Soviet jazz would turn into a purely improvisatory, free jazz form, one of the first in the world, and one which would also interact with the American avant-garde, and was actually not particularly well-loved by a lot of American critics because it differed so much from the styles that were emerging in the US. This style, in the view of Soviet critics, was jazz attaining its true freedom, the freedom that it could not have attained in the West due to capitalism. And this new form of music would integrate the styles of the various Soviet republics, would take these folk musics, but not cling to their national roots, but instead transform this music and transform culture into a post-national communist style that could encompass human existence as a utopia that existed beyond the reifying characteristics of capitalist and Western thought. This was a music that, despite what Americans would say, was radically different from what existed in the West. And it was a music that would integrate influences endemic to the Soviet Union. Like on this track, a singer from Tuva, which is a Siberian republic, taking an ancient Turkic tradition of sounds that mirror language and of a type of singing that can actually produce multiple notes at the same time, and bringing that into solo jazz improvisation. One thing that you hear in her name is Sainho Namcalak's music is the use of linguistic cues and non-linguistic ways and the manipulation of sounds like sneezes. In the previous track, we heard the Gamelin Trio, which is one of the dominant Soviet free jazz groups, which Namcalak coordinated with. And one trait that I kind of traced throughout this music and also through the Soviet criticism at the time is that what was happening in Soviet culture in the late Soviet period was that language had become highly normalized, that there were certain rituals of existence in which one had to publicly portray himself in the ways the party wanted. You had to join the youth organization, you had to go to particular meetings, you had to talk a particular way, and you had to express things in a way that made sense in the Soviet context. But underneath this normalized language was a lot of meaning in these official words that on paper meant very little. People were developing a culture that had started with the records on bones that was very different from what the words were supposed to mean. This music, this kind of music that takes dissociated, decontextualized linguistic cues, cultural cues, sounds from everyday life, and turns them into something radically different, the sounds that one would expect to mean one thing and sound official, yet coming out meaning something entirely different, was endemic. It was indicative of a cultural form endemic to the Soviet Union, in which behind what seemed like a monoculture with no pluralism, there was an incredible amount of pluralism. And indeed, if that kind of conversation and that kind of pluralism brought the Soviet Union down, then that might have been what its downfall was. But it was not because jazz taught Soviet musicians to think like Americans, or that jazz and Western culture made Soviet people free in a Western sense. Instead, it was that this music and this American cultural form provided Soviet people a vocabulary of their own subjective experience, and a way of voicing their own identity, both as individual and as collective norms, and the ways in which their existence interacted with party ideals and with state power. And indeed, if that kind of expression of identity and that kind of expression of the individual's relation to the collective was destructive of the state itself, then we might have an explanation. But it was not because jazz taught Soviet musicians to love the West entirely.